I racked my Mac Studio. Using this rack mount case gives me so many connectivity options. It not only serves as a rack mount, but it also expands its capabilities by adding a Thunderbolt enclosure that can fit 3 full-length PCIe cards and connects over Thunderbolt 3 or 4. This unlocks the Mac's full potential by allowing you to connect PCIe cards like network adapters, video capture cards, or even a super fast storage using this 16x PCIe card that can fit up to 8 NVMe SSD drives. And this rack mount case also has a built-in USB hub, cutouts that still let you access the I/O ports, an easy-to-reach power button, and even an area to keep USB or Thunderbolt drives if you decided to connect those. Today we're going to take a look at the xMac Studio Pro rack mount system from Sonnet, with the Echo 3 expansion system, and even one of their M.2 8x4 Silent Gen4 PCIe cards to add some additional storage. We're going to go through all of this today, including the rack mount case, the enclosure, testing different cards that work with the Mac, and even do some speed tests using the included NVMe card. This kind of expandability makes it hard to know why the Mac Pro even exists. So full disclosure, Sonnet did send me this system, however the 8 NVMe drives are on loan, which I'll be returning after testing. So I bet you're wondering, why a Mac Studio and why not a Mac Mini? I debated this for quite some time and I even started configuring the Mac Mini. And after I started comparing the specs of what I wanted out of a Mac Mini M2 and a Mac Studio M2, I found that for only $100 more, I was able to get twice the GPU cores, 38 in total, twice the RAM, 64 gigs in total, 2 additional USB-C ports, a media card reader, faster onboard SSDs, and even faster memory. I did have to reduce the storage down to 1 TB, but that's a sacrifice I was willing to make, knowing I could supplement the storage with a system like this from Sonnet. Now don't get me wrong, the Mac Mini is a great machine, but once you start getting into the upper end of the specs, you're better off going with a Mac Studio. The next question you're probably asking is, why rack a Mac system at all? I mean, aren't they supposed to be looked at? Joking. Kind of. I chose to rack mount my Mac Studio not because it's on brand, but because I wanted better cable management. Wait, better cable management? Yeah, cable management. Being a content creator, a streamer, and a developer, I have lots of cables and cords to connect lots of devices, like this 4K HDMI capture card that I connect to my cameras and devices to capture their output. The same goes for audio equipment, USB devices, XLR cables, and on and on. While building out my server rack in my basement, I found that having everything in one cabinet, like the server rack, makes wire management much easier, or at least easier to hide. But there are many audio and video creative professionals who do rack their audio equipment, and I guess I'm adapting this to fit my needs. So will it work? Well, let's find out.
So this is 3U, and it comes with rails too that you can attach here, along with ears to attach to the front so you can rack mount it. It has an easy to access front panel. You can unscrew this to install the Mac Studio, and you can easily remove the expansion slot by removing these screws. You can see here in the front, we have a 4-port USB hub that attaches to the Mac Studio from back here. And if you know anything about the Mac Studio, the power button's in the back, so they've included this power button. When you press the button, it actually triggers this little lever right here. You can see that moving. 100% mechanical, but that will push the Mac Studio button and then it will power it on. Underneath here, you can install 2 USB drives. And this whole entire case, the airflow comes in through here and in through here, and then comes out the back through here. So it's never recycling the same air. So if we remove these 3 screws in back, we can see the enclosure.
The enclosure that comes with the xMac Studio Echo 3 combo is actually a desktop enclosure that converts to a rack mount enclosure. It's the same internals, but without the outer case from the desktop module.
As you can see here, we have 3 PCIe Express slots right here. So this is an 8X, this is an 8X, and this is a 16X right here. So these slots can be filled with any cards you could think of, with the exception of video cards due to Apple's limitation. But we'll populate some of them here in a few, even a video card for fun. And you'll notice right here, this long power supply right here, it's really quiet, but this is a 400 watt power supply that can power everything that's plugged into here. Here we have this 6 or 8 pin auxiliary power adapter that's used to power cards that need some more power than the slot provides for it. The cool thing about this is you don't see a power switch, so this automatically powers on and off based on your system's power, so you don't need to remember to turn it on, or if you forget to turn it off, your machine powers down, it will power off too. So it has two fans that are temperature controlled and variable speed. And yes, they are Noctua fans, so you know they're gonna be ultra quiet, which is super nice. The fan on one of my PCIe devices is actually louder than these two fans together. And it's nice too that if I need to replace them, I can replace them with standard Noctua fans, so super awesome. So these two Thunderbolt ports, each of them are 40 gigabits per second, and one connects to your system, and another is used to daisy chain additional devices or additional enclosures. Now this does have a Thunderbolt 3 controller and not a Thunderbolt 4 controller, and you're probably asking, why isn't Thunderbolt 4 better? Well, not actually. It's intentional that they put this one in here because Thunderbolt 3 has four lanes of PCIe, where Thunderbolt 4 does not. Thunderbolt 4 supports three downstream ports, and it's primarily used for docking stations, and only supports one lane of PCIe, which really isn't used in a docking station anyways. So I know this sounds odd, but Thunderbolt 4 is not a successor to Thunderbolt 3. I'll link a video where Sonnet explains this a little bit better than I can, along with some diagrams, but just know that Thunderbolt 3 is in here and we're actually getting more performance because 3 is in here. So what am I gonna do with all of these slots?
One of them for sure is the Sonnet M.2 8x4 Silent Gen4 PCIe card.
It's blazing fast and it's a 16x card, and the bandwidth is available to all of the connected NVMe SSDs, which help facilitate maximum speeds. It works with Windows, Mac, or Linux computers that have a 16x slot, and it's compatible with a variety of M.2 NVMe Gen 4 and Gen 3 SSDs, but you'll want to get a Gen 4 if you're going for speed.
And here's the cool thing about this card too, is that it doesn't require a specific motherboard for RAID or any other features, and it does not require PCIe bifurcation. PCIe bifurcation is just a fancy word that means taking something and dividing it into multiple parts. If the card didn't support this, we would only see one device or need a special motherboard. But because the card does support bifurcation, the card presents multiple devices to a computer so we can see each individual drive. This makes this card very flexible. I did install 8 NVMe SSDs into the card, installed the thermal transfer pad to transfer heat from the SSD drives to the cooler. This allows me to connect 8 NVMe SSDs via Thunderbolt using the Echo 3 PCIe expansion enclosure, which pops right into the xMac Studio. So let's put all of this together, add some PCIe cards, and test various speeds and compatibility.
Okay, and the documentation says we do need to connect this power adapter if we're connecting, I think, more than six drives, and I have 8 in here, so let's connect this. Next, I wanna connect this Blackmagic deck link. So this HDMI card allows me to capture up to 4K HDMI streams coming in, and that's what I use for streaming, so let's connect this. And here's a dual 10 gig networking port. I have this or an HBA. I figured we'll throw this in here just to see how Mac handles it. And we'll try this video card a little bit later too. There we go. So my HDMI capture card, my PCI Express to NVMe adapter, and then dual 10 gig networking. Then we have Thunderbolt here. Okay, let's slide this puppy right in. Now we just need to slide the Mac Studio in. Slide this guy right in. Now it does have felt pads and everything, so you don't scratch your Mac Studio up, which is really nice. It's in there nice and snug. And this cutout, they say, is to help with Bluetooth and wireless. It's not to just show off the Apple logo, but this helps your wireless signal and your Bluetooth signal get connectivity a little bit easier than putting steel over it. And it also has a little bit of felt up here too, so it's not scratching that up, which is super nice. There we go, now that's all in there snug, and you can see here the power button. When you press it, it's that power button right there. Let's connect our USB hub. And if you want to secure this a little bit more, they've included this adapter, so you can actually make sure that it doesn't accidentally get unplugged. So let's just do that, because I don't want this to accidentally get unplugged. And that will lock it into place now. You can see it's not coming out. So let's get this powered on, hooked up, and let's test the drives and test everything else. Okay, so this is Sonoma. I just upgraded, so let's sign into here. Okay, so all of these pop-ups right here that popped up, this is actually a good sign. This is all the individual drives that are being detected by macOS, and macOS is saying, hey, I can't read these drives. It's because they're formatted a certain way because I was testing on Windows. So let's ignore all of these really quick. First, let's see if everything is detected. Spoiler alert, we saw that the drives were. This is good. So under PCI, I do see these two additional Ethernet controllers. So that's the dual 10 gig Ethernet port. And then I see all these NVMe Express controllers. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's good. And then here I see one for PCIe video, and that's my video capture card. Awesome. So the Mac is detecting all of these already over Thunderbolt. Awesome. So now that we know that this is detected, let's configure these drives. You can see all 8 drives, so I opened up Disk Utility, and let's create an array. Let's just do RAID Assistant, and let's do a striped array, so a 0. So RAID 0, I'm not gonna have any parity or any fault tolerance at all. If one dies, they all die. That's okay because we're just testing, and most likely this is going to be a scratch drive that I'll use just for my code and my temporary location for all of my cache for all of my videos, which cache is fine if it goes away. If it dies, I'll just generate more cache. And if my code dies, well, I better have it pushed up to my Git repo. And if I don't, that's my own fault. But anyways, what I think I'm gonna do in the future is do a RAID 10 where I configure striping plus a mirror so I get the benefits of speed along with some parity or some fault tolerance. But long story short, let's actually create a RAID 0. Let's add all of these drives to there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I added all 8 of those drives. Go next. The type doesn't really matter. I'm gonna keep it to macOS Extended Journal, the default that they configure these disks with. And chunk size, I guess, doesn't really matter for me either. So I'm gonna call this fast 0, just so I know which one it is. Let's go next. It's gonna tell me, hey, you're gonna destroy these drives. Yes, we want to, so we'll click create. It's creating the array, it's creating the array, still creating the array. There we go. So the RAID is now created. That's a good thing. So the RAID is created. You can see I have one called Fast Zero. It's all 8 terabytes, so these are 1 terabyte each. So I striped it across so I get all of the storage, so 8 terabytes total. See all their disks here? Awesome. And then Time Machine bugging me. And we can see it's mounted here, so we can actually go into this. Shouldn't be anything here, but that's to be expected. So let's test drive speeds. Now, a lot of people use a lot of different tools for Mac to test drive speeds, and Blackmagic Design actually has a really nice one. It's this disk speed test. And this will run a test indefinitely, and it will give you a good output of your write speed and your read speed. But I wanted to be able to compare something to Windows. And on Windows, I use CrystalMark Disk, and that gives me some good data. And I wanted to have something similar on macOS, and that's when I found this Amorphous Disk Mark, which looks exactly like the Windows version. So I'm gonna use this so that I can compare this later on to Windows. So let's select the drive from here, and I'm gonna choose the fast one. Now it's gonna ask me, hey, where do we wanna store this temp file? I'm gonna choose in this fast drive, just right in the root is fine. I think the default that they have set is around 1 gig. I'm gonna set it to 8 gig, and that's the test file size or the sample size. And then how many times we wanna run the test. You can put this anywhere from 1 to 9. I think 5 is pretty good. So let's actually run this now. So run all tests. Okay, so the test is done. And the most interesting thing for me here is the sequential read and the sequential write. Now, why am I most interested in that? Well, because this speed test is actually testing the Thunderbolt, the PCIe Express, and the actual card that's inside of there. And so what we're seeing here is that it's actually reading and writing about the same, about 2800 megabytes per second. And if my back of napkin math is correct, that's about 22 gigabits per second, which is super duper fast, faster than 10 gig networking, faster than 20 gig networking. But still, it's not the advertised speed of 40 gigabits per second that you're supposed to get on Thunderbolt. After talking to their engineers and even talking to Wendell a little bit, I figured out that 2800 megabytes per second is actually the theoretical max of Thunderbolt 3. So Thunderbolt, as I understand it, has some overhead, and it also reserves some space for displays. It seems like a lot. I don't know. But 22 gigabits per second is no slouch. That's super fast and good enough for my cache drives, and good enough for my code storage drive to actually run my builds. Now, it's not a limitation of the card, it's a limitation of Thunderbolt. Okay, so I mentioned the HDMI capture card, and I want to test that too, because that's really important for me to be able to capture HDMI input for streaming and for my video creation. Okay, plug that into there. And then for the capture, I'm actually going to output from my Zima board into there. So if this works, we should just see a Windows desktop. Let's make sure that this is the right, there it is, so it's on 4. Going to OBS, let me actually switch this to 4.
Awesome. So we see a Windows loading screen and we should see the Windows sign-in screen. And that's pretty awesome. So that means the HDMI capture also works with capturing HDMI output, which is awesome because I need to do that. And there's a Windows sign-in screen. And so we talked about video cards too. Let me install a video card into here so we can test it out. I think we know what the result's gonna be because, you know, Apple. But let's install one just to see what it does. So here's the video card we're gonna test. It's just one I have laying around, but it's an NVIDIA 1550. The main reason why I'm using this is because it pulls all of its power from the PCI Express slot and we don't need to connect additional power. So let's do that. Okay, so this is connected. Let's get her back in. So now we're signed in. Let's go check about this Mac. More info. See, we don't have a display, but could be because it's not connected. Go into system report. Let's go down to PCI. Oh, and here it is. Interesting. So it does detect it. You can see it detects a display card, VGA compatible controller, driver installed. No. And then you can also see this device, which is the audio device, which is the audio controller that's built in for the audio over HDMI. And you can see here too that the driver is not installed. So no real sense of connecting anything to it. Thanks, Apple. Now, for those of you who are looking to rack your Mac Studio, there are few mounting options out there. But the Mac Studio offers the additional Thunderbolt expansion system that really takes rack mounting it to the next level. The combination of racking and expandability let me use my Mac the way I want to use it. And Thunderbolt connectivity ensures that I can connect this to any system that I want in the future. A new Mac system, a new Windows machine, or Linux, or even if I get a laptop. Overall, I think it's a great system, even if Thunderbolt and macOS has some limitations. While I learned a lot about Thunderbolt 3 and 4, the Mac Studio, the xMac Studio system, and I hope you learned something too. And remember, if you found anything in this video helpful, don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.